Sufi terminology that are used in tariqah. As an aspirant, we have to be familiar with both terms. I spoke on zikr, which is also known as dhikr. What is the significance of this? When you go by somebody's house, how do you enter the building or the house where you have to go and meet the person? You knock at the door. If you have to go to the office and meet somebody, you have to knock at the door, and when you get a response from within, then you enter the place. If you are going to visit somebody's house, you use the call bell. You can use your cell phone and call the person that I am outside at the gate, or simply you call. These are all the ways and means of seeking the attention of the person to whom you are going to visit and knock at the door. In the same way, zikr is knock at the door where consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or God resides in human being. It is the qalb, the heart center, which needs to be invoked in order to continue journey along the Sufi path. As a result, zikr is important. Zikr invokes your heart center and prepares it for the further journey. There is no other purpose of that. When you knock at the door and there is a response from within, you do not continue standing there and knocking at the door. You knock at the door, response comes, come in, come right in. Then you do not stand at the door and continue to knock. But in zikr, if we do not understand, even when heart center is open, the aspirants continue to do the zikr, which is wrong. And many times even sheikhs do not tell you that you have to stop zikr now. In the beginning, this zikr is intentional. This remembrance is intentional. It is loud. Thereafter, along the path, it becomes silent. Just as your heart beat, just as your breath is continuously coming in and going out, at each breath you are aware of this. You are not continuing the word loud. Instead, now you are hearing that the sound that is surrounding you. There is constantly a word, a sound, a music happening in the existence. But because of the clutter of the mind, the noise of our ego, we cannot hear that sound. So we have to create our own sound so that we can hear it. And it always happens that unless we hear our own words, we really do not hear. The sound is so subtle that we cannot hear. When somebody says something, are you ready to go? You repeat, ready to go? Yes. This always happens. So zikr is that kind of repetition that reminds you that there is something being spoken to you in a subtle form and you have to listen to it. Ultimately, the purpose of zikr is that you become so silent that you are constantly hearing even the small sounds that is happening in the existence. And unless your zikr is transformed into zikr khafi, means silent listening, you have not yet learned the art of zikr. First of all, understand that zikr is a knock at the door, at the heart center, so that you can hear a word from inside, come right in. And unless and until this happens, you continue to knock at the door of the person. The moment it happens, you do not continue knocking. Instead, you straight away go inside, full of respect and gratitude that the person who is inside has allowed you to come in. And then you are constantly grateful to the person that he had allowed you to come in the private chamber. Then zikr becomes hafi. There is another terminology that is used in Sufi way is known as hadra. It is also a part of zikr, which is practiced primarily in Arab world. The word hadra means presence in Arabic. And zikr also refers to presence. You are being aware of the presence that is there within you. You had been seeking that presence outside, but it is deep within you. Then the next term is Qawwali. Qawwali is a form of devotional Sufi music which is part of Chishtiya order. It is common in Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, Afghanistan, Iran and Turkey. It is known for its secular strains. Some of the modern day masters have included Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan, Sabri Brothers, Amir Khusro, a disciple of Nizamuddin Aulia of Chishtiya order, actually started this particular form of worship. At the shrine of Khwaja Ghareeb Nawaz, that is Hazrat Khwaja Muinuddin Chishti Razi Allah Ta'ala Unho, at Ajmer Sharif, during the time of Urs or annual congregation, various poets, Qawwals, come to pay their homage to the Sheikh. It is a way of singing the praises of Holy Prophet Hazrat Paighambar Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, O Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, or the Sheikhs of the order. It is the singing in the praise of Allah. Qasida and Naat also form the part of this devotional singing. Qawwali forms an important form of all spiritual functions or urs at the shrines of the Sufi masters. During the time of urs, for days together, there is a congregation, there is a continuous singing of qawwalis, naats, qasidas to commemorate the occasion. Various qawwals, poets come from all over the place to pay their homage in the form of these devotional songs. Then the next word that comes in the Sufi terminology is Sama. Sama is an Arabic word. It implies listening. Sama refers to a Sufi practice which can involve music and dance. Sufi whirling is a form of Sama, something that captivates the heart of the seekers, where the environment is created that you are drowning in, that is known as Sama. When a concert takes place, there is a kind of a Sama or environment is created that captivates the people and everybody begins to drown into it. That particular form is known as Sama in Sufi terminology. When you are seeing the Sufi dervish continuing to do whirling and that captivates your heart, you are spellbound by it. This is known as Sama. And sometimes it happens in that state. Something happens to you and your heart center is invoked. Sama is a form of opportunity that creates an energy field for transformation. This includes a dance form also originated with Sufi rituals, singing. Any circumstance or situation that creates an energy field and environment is known as Sama. Tilawat is a next term. Tilawat refers to seclusion and it is also a form of retreat. Once it was widespreadly known throughout the Sufi realm, but now it is less common. It may be prescribed by a sheikh of a particular order for his murid or talib, that is a student. Muslims believe that most of the prophets and also Mary, the mother of Isa alayhi salam or Jesus, lived in some form of seclusion at some point in their life. Every seeker has to entertain this form of seclusion. Hazrat Khwaja Ubaidullah Ahrar Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unhu, he was a king by profession because his father was a king, and he continued that work that was assigned to him by his father. But after he finished the day's work, he used to retire in his seclusion. Every seeker, every sheikh does this, because according to the Sufi order, unless a master can make his own living, he has no right to work for Allah Subhanahu. Each sheikh works in whatever profession he is. He is in a family tradition or a job, private or the government, and then he continues. Even in that state, he continues to do his work and then he retires into seclusion where he is no more. He is virtually cutting off all ties or all bondages as a remembrance. You live into the world that I am a husband, I am a wife, I am the son, I am the father, I am the this, I am that. And in that we forget our real identification that I am the consciousness, the nur, the light. So in order for that remembrance, the master goes into the solitude. I continue to do my work of trading the items, the food items that I market, because that is my way of life and living. And during that process, I interact with many people. In that way, the sheikh leaves an impression on the hearts of the people whom he interacts with. When my day's work is finished, then I retire into my solitary realm, where I am no more a businessman, no more a husband, no more a friend. I am just a presence. This is known as hilawat or seclusion. At some point, Hazrat Paighambar sallallahu alaihi wasallam adopted the practice of meditating alone for several weeks every year in a cave on Mount Hira near Mecca. And it is there in that state of solitude, he heard the ilham, the word of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Islamic tradition holds that in one of his visits to Mount Hira, the angel Gabriel began communicating with him here in the year 610 and commanded Hazrat Paighambar sallallahu alaihi wasallam to recite the following verse. Proclaim or read, in the name of thy Lord and Cherisher, created man out of his mere clot of congealed blood, proclaim. And thy Lord is most bountiful. He who taught the use of pen, taught men that which he knew not. Quran-e-Pak, Quran-e-Majid, 96, verse 1 to 5. It is in those moments of solitude that you begin to hear these small sounds, which are considered to be the message of the unknown and unknowable. It is in those moments when all the noise and the clatter is no more, you are in commune with that which is the unknown and unknowable.